Hey, what's going on? It's Bill Burr, and it's time for the Thursday afternoon, just before Friday, Monday morning podcast at I'm just checking in on you. How are you? How's your week going? Oh, don't worry. It's almost over. It's Thursday, right? Don't you get paid on Thursday? Back in the day, you did. You get that fucking check, right? That little piece of paper with the numbers on it. Then you go down to the bank, you write on the back, you stick it in the machine, and then the numbers say you got this number, right? It's just a bunch of numbers. That's all it is. That's all it comes down to. I'm in a great mood. I got a great night's sleep last night. Went out and visited some friends of mine and drove home about 80 miles an hour, 85, sometimes 90. Oh, I was cruising. And even when, you know, they fix the highways at night, you know, which totally makes sense. You can't do it during the day, but you always get mad at night. You're like, Jesus fucking Christ. Even if there isn't traffic, they got to invent a traffic jam. Right? And you get all fucking mad because they're fixing a highway at fucking 1:30 in the morning when you should be in bed, right? When the fuck else are they going to do it? That's what I just kept telling myself as I was getting mad. You know, I'd be cruising along. This is fucking great. This is great. Look at this. Flying down the fucking highway, 90 fucking miles an hour. You should be able to do this all the time. 24/7. Get the population down where whenever I fucking want, I can jump on the highway. Yeah, be there in 5 minutes. Oh, wah! Right over. Right? And then all of a sudden you come over the hill and you see that arrow and then you see the brake lights and you just go, ah, you fucking assholes. You know, I had AC/DC cranking because I'm a middle-aged, not even middle-aged, I'm 47 times two is fucking 94. Who's kidding who? You guys think old red face is going to make 95? I'm an old fuck. I'm an old white guy who likes Facebook and I'm listening to AC/DC and I'm rocking out. In my hybrid. Oh yeah, that's what I'm doing. I'm doing everything but wearing those Mervin shoes. What are those fucking awful shoes that people a little bit older than me wear? And they wear them with no socks and dad jeans. Those slip-on fucking shoes that I think were cool for like 2 weeks in like 1993. They're Mervins, right? Melvins. What's a Melvin? Isn't a Melvin if somebody fucking gives you a wedgie? Who the fuck ever thought to do that? Do you realize how funny that is? I guess nobody thought to do it until there was pants. And then once there was pants, somebody's just like, ah, goddamn, these things are riding up on me. And then it just rode up on the wrong sadistic guy's ass. And he was like, you know what? What if I did that a lot quicker to somebody else, a lot harder? On purpose, premeditated, riding up of the jeans. And when he heard the scream of uncomfortableness, it warmed his heart. And then some other sadistic fuck saw it. Or maybe just some fucking, you know, like joke thieves, except like a fucking bully, like thief. I wonder if bullies do that. Like they see a bully bullying somebody else and be like, you know, I'm going to do something like that. I'm going to do my version of that. Then the bully calls them out on Twitter. Then there's a big dust up, right? Then they got to go on a bully podcast and clear their name. Anyways, who knows? Who knows in this day and age of non-controversies becoming controversies? Who knows what could happen? Yeah, I'm in a great mood. I got home, 1:30 in the morning. I put on the Celtics. I still haven't even watched the Bruins beating the Canadians. I know they beat the Canadians. I'm fucking trying to do the basketball and hockey thing. And so I'm behind like two games with the Bruins. And I know they got Vancouver tonight. And I just checked the standings. What the fuck happened to the Canadians? My Boston Bruin heart was in my fucking throat when they started off at 9-0. I'm like, oh no, they're going to end the drought this year. They're going to end the drought. And then what am I going to say? I got nothing. I already have. The only thing I can't say is how long it's been since they won their last one. Because other than that, they can go like, yeah, well, we got like 52 of them. It's like, yeah, but you know, the first 12 you were beating like, you know, the fucking Montreal Marauders. The Quebec Conquistadors. You know, you won best fucking best 5 out of 9, whatever the fucking series was when you played on a pond. Do you realize how fucked up it is when the Stanley Cup was the size of a shot glass? You know, hurry up and finish this game so we can have World War One. That's really, I mean, I don't give a fuck that they count those things. I just like teasing them about it. Even if they just count the ones from the modern era, we're never going to catch them. I realize that as a fan. But what was I going to say? I still, for the life of me, do not understand, as we are now at Super Bowl 50, why NFL championships do not count. Nobody has ever been able to give me a logical explanation to that. All right? Is it because the two leagues combined rather than the NFL absorbed the AFL? You know, the way the NBA absorbed, you know, like 4 or 5 ABA teams? Is that what it is? But for the life of me, it's like those championships were won. They were won during those years. Like, take like the Eagles. The Eagles, like, oh, they never won a fucking, you know, a Super Bowl. Who gives a fuck? I mean, that sucks. I mean, it's been a long fucking time. But they did win a championship in 1960. Okay? And the way the NFL acts like that was caveman days. Like, Mickey Mantle was in the prime of his career. Baseball still drops to their knees, you know, in honor of that guy. Okay? And forget about fucking Babe Ruth, you know? Whose fucking rehab was eating hot dogs and drinking beer and catching up to the fucking, the team on the train by jumping in a biplane if he wasn't too fucking fat with weight and balance, right? If they could find a scarf long enough to wrap around his giant fucking elephant neck, right? Why don't they count those? That move, Jim Brown's title doesn't count. What was it, 64, 65, the last time the Browns won it? / Ravens? I don't know. I don't even know what the fuck I'm talking about. I thought I was in a good mood. I'm already going cunty. Anyways, yeah, I don't know what happened to the Canadians. Like, as of today, they are 1 point. The season ended today. They wouldn't make the playoffs. So I'm going to go out on a limb and say that Canadians team, I'll tell you, those Montreal Canadiens, they're very streaky. I'll tell you right now, if they're not looking unbeatable, they're looking unwinnable. Whatever the fuck you'd say. Anyways, let me plow ahead here. So, I got to watch that game at some point, but I'm getting ready to do the Patrice O'Neill benefit. The wonderful Patrice O'Neill, the best comic I ever fucking saw, you know, for my generation. It's just it. It's just a fact. He's the best. And a wonderful, positive night of hilarity, supporting the people that Patrice was taking care of, all his loved ones. That is Tuesday, and from what I hear, it's all sold out, but we will be releasing at the last second a few tickets here or there, which I guess is what they do at all concerts. People always say that, going like, you know, oh, I wanted to see fucking whatever band, you know? And dude, you just like an hour before, you just walk up and they release tickets. That's like some sick fucking level of being able to get tickets, you know, because I'd be the asshole. I'd just go to fucking StubHub. Speaking of which, I wanted to go see Bob Newhart. Bob Newhart is doing a show out in the desert at some casino, right? When I say out in the desert, I mean the 10 East, out to like La Quinta, right? He's out there because, you know, I think that's his generation. That's where they fucking, that's where they retired. You know, that place was like what Brooklyn is now. Oh, like Silver Lake out here, like where all the hipsters are. That's what that was to his generation, I think, way back in the day. And those people stayed out there and they retired. So I go on the interweb there, as Richard Rawlings says on Gas Monkey. I go on the interweb and I try to get tickets. Sold the fuck out. I was so upset that I couldn't get a fucking ticket. But on the other level, I'm like, this guy's 83 years old and he's still selling out the big room in a casino. You know how fucking awesome that is? Incredible. You know how ridiculous it is that he's worked clean his whole career and I'm sitting here cursing up a storm, giving him compliments? I'm going to figure out a way. I'm going to get to that show. It's on January 29th. I'm going to figure out a way to get in there. I don't know what I got to do. You know, maybe I'll fucking drive all the way out to the desert and I'll stand around, you know? Hoping that maybe a couple of audience members died. The tickets got freed up. oh, come on, Bill. Let's not take it to a negative place this close to the AFC and NFC championship games. How could you do that? You know, speaking of dying, by the way, speaking of death, you know, I went on the internet today and I was looking up, where the fuck is it? Oh, here it is. Here it is. Install later. Get out of here. Beat it. Try in an hour. Try tonight. Jesus, how can you be more fucking needy? All right. Where is it? New York City discusses world's largest tax-funded mass grave might be turned into a park. Now, I lived in New York. Start spreading the news. I'm wearing sweatpants. I'm gonna go down to Ted Steaks and eat some shit. And I'll feel like I'm making it there. You know, successful New Yorkers think just because they're in Manhattan. You know what I mean? Everybody looks at themselves like they're the star. You know, no one sees themselves as background. You know what I mean? You're the ones waving up at the Beatles. You're not in the Beatles. You understand? You're the one in the crowd screaming, you know, fainting as security takes you out as you're looking at somebody successful. Right? That's who you are. You're those people already on the subway as they try to jam another person in there. And the world needs you. The world needs you, okay? If I can go to White Castle and eat 18 of those burgers, I'll be a fat-titted fuck in the upper deck. Sorry. All right, world's largest tax-funded mass grave. So there's an island out there, which I had no idea. I mean, I knew of Ellis Island, and then there's the island that the Statue of Liberty is on. Then I knew there was one that the Navy owned or some shit. But there's this other island out there that they just bury people that don't have any money or nobody knows who the fuck they are. It's called Heart Island, or as a tourist from Boston would say, fucking Heart Island. Let's go out to Heart Island, dude. Maybe we can find our fucking uncle. Got in trouble with a bookie. Heart Island, New York. Rosalie Grable looks down over rows of white pipes, some broken or covered in mud. Sticking out of the dirt. Each tube marks the grave of 150 adults, homeless, poor, veterans, and unclaimed individuals who couldn't afford anything but a spot in what's widely believed to be the world's largest tax-funded mass grave. You know, tax-funded mass grave, not mass grave, because believe me. I think, isn't there one underneath, like Wall Street? They just massacred a bunch of Native Americans or some shit, and then they just bury them all. Isn't that what they used to do back then? All right, that takes care of that. Who wants to build a log cabin, right? Lunatics. So whatever. Grable, a 64-year-old resident of the Upper West Side, wants grass and wildflowers to hide the dirty white plastic. She's come here to honor her mother, who died in a hospital bed with no savings to leave to her daughter. She said, I'm still getting used to the idea that my mommy wound... still calls her mommy. That's creepy. Wound up in a potter's grave. I know that's my mother. I know that my mother was expecting something more much more traditional. I don't understand people who, like, when they die, they want to have one of those above-ground fucking, like, tombs. You know? Like the it's like the above-ground swimming pool of grave sites. You know, it's like, how fucking special do you think you are? Who gives it? You're dead. They should just have mass graves. They should have a giant pit. You just fucking, you know, the family doesn't need to see it, but you just fucking throw it in there. Throw it in there, and then as you dissolve, you become the next fossil fuel. Right? Think about all the fucking people that have lived in the world. If we had in one giant fucking massive grave in each country, and you used whatever fucking, whatever, I don't know how the fuck you end up turning into motor oil, but evidently that's what happens. I know if you jump off a building, you explode like a water balloon because you're mostly water. And I don't know, if you eat a lot of Italian food, you know, like I do, you got a lot of olive oil in you, who knows? Maybe you might help out somebody's fucking lawnmower in the future. That's what they should do. Holy shit, did I just solve global warming? Or maybe I solved the Middle East crisis. And if elected, I will begin burying all dead Americans in the same hole. And 100 years from now, we will use the fossil fuel that is created to free ourselves from the Saudi Arabians. I am so sick of seeing world leaders go to the UN and act like we have a friend, some sort of a friendship. I don't know if that's something you could do. But anyways, I became fascinated with that expression. I hope I'm saying it right. Potter's grave. So I looked it up. And of course, you know, my research on the internet never goes past Wikipedia. Never goes past it, you know. All right. A potter's field, pauper's field, or a common grave is a term for a place for the burial of unknown or indigent people. Or is that indigent? All right. So I clicked on indigent or indigent. Isn't it astounding how fucking dumb I am? The only thing most astounding about how stupid I am is the fact that you guys fucking listen to this. I actually thought I was halfway smart until I started reading out loud here. I-N-D-I-G-E-N-T. Indigent? Indigent. You say tomato, I say indigent. What, indigent? Indigent? I'm just going to stop saying it. I feel like every time I say it, I'm like that guy, I'm playing blackjack going, hit me, over, over. Your fucking IQ's just going down. All right. So I looked up that word that I'm not going to say anymore. Oh, God, is it possible to get embarrassed on a podcast that only you are doing? You know, if it's possible, I'm doing it. All right. What ends up coming up is poverty. Poverty is a general scarcity, dearth, or the slate of one's money. Well, how did this come to, after the Industrial Revolution, mass production in factories made production goods increasingly less expensive and more accessible. Of more importance is the modernization of the agriculture, such as fertilizer. Poverty reduction is a major goal. Oh, give me a, is it really? Is it really a major goal when the fucking CEO takes 80% of the profits? Huh? One of the guys who's fucking working the line, his daughter's already hooking, is up in the CEO's office blowing him. You know? Because she can't go to fucking college, and then the circle is complete. Oh, that was a little poetry there. All right, the U.S. expression, let me get back to the Potter's Field. The U.S. expression, Potter's Field, derives from the Bible. Oh, Jesus. Referring to a field used for the extraction of potter's clay. Such land used for agriculture could be used as a burial site. So after they dug out all the clay, they just threw people in there? Well, there you go. That's a good use of space. All right, the term comes... Oh, let's read some Bible. Oh, my God, I've never done this. Read some Bible? Let's read from the Bible. The term comes from Matthew 27... colon 3-27:8 in the New Testament of the Bible, in which Jewish priests take 30 pieces of silver returned by a remorseful Judas, oh, Jesus, this would be some anti-Semitic shit. Okay, and then this is what it says. Then Judas, who betrayed him, I think that's J-Star, he betrayed J-Star there. Seeing that he was condemned, repenting himself, brought back the 30 pieces of silvers to the chief priests and ancients, saying, I have sinned in betraying innocent blood. But they said, what is that to us? Look thou to it. Yep, there you go. There's the anti-Semitism right there. Hey, what do we give a shit? Just give us the silver pieces there, Judy. And casting down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed and went and hanged himself with a halter. A halter top? They had those back then? But he hanged himself with a little fucking sports bra? But the chief priests, having taken the pieces of silver, said, it's not lawful to put them into the Corbona. Didn't Chrysler used to make those? The Chrysler Corbona with Corinthian leather. The term mite box. What the f... A mite box? Isn't that a bug? Also, alms box or poor box refers to a box that is used to save coin, or a piggy bank. That's what you should say, to save coins for charitable purposes. Oh, for charitable purposes. Oh, so then, okay, I get it. So then they say, wait a minute. This guy killed the king of the Jews, and we're sitting here with the fucking loot from the caper. Well, go stick it in the fucking donation box. And nobody says a word. You got me? All right. And then after that, they had consulted together. You know what? This might be a new section. You want me to, guys? I'll start reading the fucking Bible, and I'll give you my interpretation of it. Gradually, I'll start my own church, right? And I'll say that I have a direct link to he that is the oneth, And then gradually I'll slide my direct length over into just saying, hey, maybe I'm that guy. I am that guy. I am him. Blow me. I'm fucking all the women here. And you guys get out in the field and grow some more apples. It's basically fast forwarding through running a cult. Oh, is the FBI here? Everybody drink this. Over the lips and over the gums. Suck it down. Here they come. All right. The site referred to these verses known as... That's really interesting and fucking sad. There is something sad about that, right? Has anybody ever had like a fucking marquee on their head site? You know, like a big gravestone? And then just have like, you know, like the Chicago theater, but like to scale to a headstone? Performing here for eternity or some hacky fucking form of show business. Oh, Christ. Now I got to look this shit up. Those people who have wacky headstones saying. Here we go. Funny headstones. All right. Here we go. What do we got here? Images for funny headstones. Now, what are the odds any of these are going to be funny? All right. Charlie, oh, this is just a funny name. Charlie Loser, born in 1887, and John Loser. Jesus Christ, they're such losers. They're buried in the same fucking place. Joke's over. Let me out now. Leslie Nielsen, he's got a joke on his. What does it say? Let her rip. I don't know what the fuck that means. Well, these are just funny names. Stiff, Titman, Boogers, Spanx. Who put this up here? Fucking Beavis and Buffett, Butthead, one's Butthead. I mean, funny sayings. Jesus Christ, the internet. Funny sayings, headstones. Here we go. Oh, my God. This is a riot. Oh, epitaphs. Here we go. 15 of the funniest epitaphs. All right, somebody has dot, dot, dot. Well, this sucks. That's not bad. Billy Wilder, I'm a writer, but then nobody's perfect. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. It's such an NPR joke. Jack Lemmon in... Oh, it's like a movie headstone. Jack Lemmon was one hell of an actor and a funny one to boot. Here he stars in his final role. Well, in the ground. Ah, that's a good one. This one gets to the point. Well, this sucks. Here's another one. All right, this one, this ain't bad once you get used to it. That's not bad. I was supposed to live to be 102 and be shot by a jealous husband. Near this spot. You know something? Actually, if they were all interesting, I think people would go to fucking graveyards more rather than getting creeped out by it. Near this spot, Samuel Whitmore, then 80 years old, killed three British soldiers. He was shot... He was shot, bayoneted, beaten, and left for dead, but recovered and lived to be 90 years of age. This guy's talking shit. Here I lie, but don't you cry, for one day too, you will die. Ah, what a cunt. Leslie Nielsen, let her rip. Merv Griffin, I will not be right back after this message. There's the winner right there. I like that. Somebody wrote, ha, get it? Such a comedian. You can't make anybody happy on the internet. All right, Bill Kugel. He never voted for Republicans and had little to do with them. Ugh. That was bad. Here's one said, I told you I was sick. That's funny. Another one, I knew this would happen. Some of these are pretty good. Rodney Dangerfield, there goes the neighborhood. Here lies something, something. Hanged by mistake in 1882. He was right. We was wrong. But we stand him up. And now he's gone. Oh, dude, you can't go with poetry. I guess that's it. Well, there you go, guys. That's about as good as it gets. And you know you can do better. Why don't you just have what the fuck are you looking at? I don't know. Let's read the advertising, shall we? A lot of death this week. A lot of death on the podcast. All right. Oh, here we go. The reads for this week. Club W. My daddy went to Yale. We've all been there. You come home after a long, exhausting day. right? You want to get shit-faced. All you want is a sip of, you want to sip a glass of wine and relax so you can lie to yourself that you're not an alcoholic because you're drinking wine. But unless you planned ahead, you probably don't have a bottle in your house. You've already spent enough time wandering around the grocery store. You know, don't get lost in the wine aisle. You just end up picking out a bottle based on the label. You don't really understand it. You get home, you open it, you realize you don't like Chardonnay as much as you thought you did, and your whole evening stinks, right? Please include all of the following points. I'm going to. You wrote it. Well, with Club W, Daddy, can you get me into Yale too? Swear to God, I'll study. You never have to go about worrying. You never have to worry about being wine-free again with Club W. Daddy, I puked on the dean. It's a revolutionary new wine club that sends you wine directly to your door, saving you all those trips to the grocery store. Not only does Club W, I'm not really the president. I just hang out in the Oval Office. Send you wine. They send you wine that you'll love drinking. Club W, my mom's name's Barbara. Easy six-question quiz figures out your palate, so every bottle you receive is quickly tailored to your tastes. Club W is leading the grape-to-glass wine revolution. I cannot even remotely read this week. They work directly with vineyards to cut out the middleman, which saves you money. Club W, I'm going to run again. Even offers a no-risk guarantee that you'll love what they send you. Call to action. And right now at Club W, I can speak Spanish, is offering my listeners 50% off your first order when you go to clubw.com/burr. Don't ever come home to a wine-free house again. Just go to clubw.com/burr to get 50% off your first order. Club W, my friend shot another friend in the face with a shotgun. .com/burr. All right, ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter, as a business owner, your company is only as good as the people you hire. Posting jobs in one place, well, that isn't enough to find quality candidates. Short staffing leaves little time to post to dozens of job sites. Well, I have the solution with ZipRecruiter. You can post to 100-plus job sites with one single click. Be instantly matched to candidates from over 6 million resumes. Plus, you can watch brand-new candidates roll into ZipRecruiter. Easy-to-use interface within 24 hours. ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. Insert an improved user testimony. (Parentheses). Please reference testimonial addendum document. (Parentheses). Offer and call to action. I'm reading all this shit from now on. Today you can try ZipRecruiter for free. Go to ZipRecruiter.com/burr. That's ZipRecruiter.com/burr. Hi, one more time, ZipRecruiter.com/burr. And lastly, but not leastly, Trunk Club. Do you hate going to the malls, but you want to look cool? What if a whole trunk full of fucking clothes came to your door? Well, it's easy. Just go to Trunk Club. Don't waste a second of the new year in a crowded mall. With Trunk Club, you can make 2016 your most stylish year yet. Hey! And the best part is you won't have to do any of the work yourself. 2016 is going to be your game changer. You're going to be getting pussy like you never got. Your fresh start. Start the year off on the right foot, in the right pants, wearing the right jackets, over the right shirt. Trunk Club is here to handle your wardrobe so you can focus on what matters, watching ESPN. Please include all of the following points in your read. Well, you wrote them. I'm going to read them. Trunk Club takes the hassle, man, out of shopping by finding the best clothes for you and your style. You'll look like $1 million or at least $1,000, and we'll always have the perfect clothes for the season at trunkclub.com/burr. You answer simple questions about your style, your preferences, and sizes, and it's all assigned. All of those things are assigned to you by an expert stylist. Your stylist will handpick. I'm an expert. I know what a shirt looks like. Your stylist will handpick clothes from the best premium brands just to prove what you like and send back what you don't like. And just like that, a trunk arrives on your doorstep filled with handpicked clothes that are perfect for you. Handpicked clothes from migrant workers out in the orange groves, out in the shirt groves. Try them on, keep what you like, and easily return what you don't in the prepaid trunk. Trunk Club is not a subscription service. You only pay for the clothes you keep from your trunk. No hidden charges, just great clothes. Call to action slash offer. It's a brand new year full of possibilities. And with Trunk Club, you'll start the year off looking great in clothes picked just for you. Get started today. How would they not know what the fuck to do at this point? Good Lord, this is long. Get started today. Trunk Club will style you for free shipping both ways. You only pay for the clothes you keep. You've already made these points. To take advantage, go to trunkclubs.com/burr. That's trunkclub.com/burr for a trunk filled with clothes you'll love wearing. In case you didn't notice that the first 50 times I said it. Additional points to mention, parentheses, not required. Trunk Club also offers locations in LA, Chicago, Dallas, DC, and New York City where you can meet one-on-one with your own personal stylist. Eight things to do during a quarter-life crisis. A quarter-life crisis. Don't you love how advertising could just come up with a fucking phobia you never had? Who has a quarter-life crisis? Oh, my God, I'm 25. What am I going to do? Was the volume this far down? Did I accidentally kick the volume? Oh, shit. Yeah, Christ. Don't worry. I'm still working on the garage. And I'm gonna figure out how to make this fucking work. Okay, it's becoming once again everything in this house is a motherfucker. And what I've finally learned to do is I'm not fighting the house. I'm not fighting the house anymore. I will adapt to it. All right. If everything has to be some sort of geometric shape that doesn't exist yet, that has no definition, then goddamn it, that will be the shape of the fucking room. All right. Is there anything else I wanted to talk about? Oh man, this lady fucking cut me off when I was driving, and just the fucking thoughts I had, and everyone that you have, like, I can't do that. I'd go to jail. I can't do that. I'd put her eye out, you know? I was thinking about pulling up next to her if I had a paint gun and her sticking her face out the window to give me the finger, like they all do, and just fucking blasting her right in the face. And I was thinking about her eyes, so that's where the paintball went, and put her eye out. And I go, no, back the fantasy up, okay? Take it down a notch, right in the middle of her forehead. Hit her right in the forehead and watch the Botox shoot out on either side. Nah, but then, you know, people behind me would take down my plate. And I just was sitting at the red light behind her. All of these fantasies of the shit I wanted to do. Follow her. Find out where she fucking works. Slash all of her tires and then take the knife. Stick it right into the headrest of her driver's side seat. You know, with something fucking written in newspaper writing. So, you know, when you take the fucking letters from the newspaper, so it looks totally even more creepy. And I was like, Bill, why would you do that? There's going to be cameras in the parking lot. You can't do that. And then the light turned green and she made a right. And I kept going straight and I just never thought about her again until right now. And with that, that is the, you guys have any, let me hear some, why don't you write those in? The murderous fantasies that you have when somebody cuts you off in fucking traffic. All the shit that you think about doing, but you don't do because that's the difference between you and a psycho. All you do is think it, but you don't fucking, you don't carry it out. You know? Well, at least I hope you do, or else I probably just got put on some sort of watch list. You know? Who gives a fuck? I'd love to be put on a watch list, and I would love to be watching them watch me and see how long they could watch me before they fucking nodded off. Is he watching another hockey game? Oh, my God, this is the worst assignment ever. Jesus Christ. All right, that's the Thursday afternoon just before Monday, just before Friday, Monday morning podcast. Have a great weekend, you cunts. Let's go Patriots. I think this is going to be, as always, it's going to be a very tough game. Oh, by the way, I finally watched the Carolina-Seattle game. And this is what I have to say. You know, I find it amazing that the Carolina Panthers, when they had 2 weeks before that game even came, right? They had a week off. So they had 2 weeks and millions of dollars at their disposal to get that field into a better, like, into much better shape for that great Seattle defense. It's amazing how they just, for some reason, couldn't get that together. Now, it's not illegal. All you really have to do is just have a feel and paint some lines and put some numbers on it. You're not required to have it in the greatest of shape. But that was just one of those things. As a Patriots fan, you just look at it and go, oh, isn't that funny? I wonder what would happen if we were to do something like that, even though it's not illegal. That'd be a nice fucking 5 days.
Are the Patriots up to it again?
Anyway, so we're going into Denver. We're going into Denver. It should be a tough game. And I have a melancholy feeling about this. Like, this might be the last Brady-Peyton-Manning matchup, you know? And if Peyton Manning retires after this year, and then there's just one, right? Tom Terrific. And then someday he'll be gone. He'll be retired. And it's just, it's going to be like, Jesus fucking Christ. I remember when they came in the fight. When those guys came in the league, I was already in my 30s, wasn't I? When did Peyton come in? 97. I turned 30 in 98. So 30, yeah, 29, 30 years old. Unfucking believable. And they're considered old. I'll be in my 50s when Tom Brady retires, God willing. God fucking willing. God willing he plays that long, and God willing I fucking make it there. I make it into my 50s and don't end up in a fucking potter's grave. You know, I wouldn't give a shit. I think that's the most arrogant fucking thing you could possibly do is give a fuck how your dead body's presented for the rest of fucking time. That's just the fucking, it's just like, dude, just frisbee my body off the back of a pickup truck down a cliff. I don't give a shit. Oh, by the way, what the, that just reminded me of something. What the fuck was I going to say? Ah, Christ, it left me. It left me like all thoughts do. All right, so that's the podcast. Have a great weekend, you cunts. Should be a great game out in Denver. I love their defense. Of course, I don't think it's going to be an easy game. And I am surprised that we are favorites because we have historically not done well out in Denver. And it always fucking snows. All right, that's it. I'll talk to you. Talk to you cunts on Monday. Got that, you know, he went over to Uganda. That guy, Coney, 2012. You see that? You see how quickly they brought that guy down? This guy shines a light on the on himself first and foremost, and how he and his child are dealing with it, which was really bizarre. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but it was enough for me to see the boy soldier crying because he saw his brother have his neck sliced right in front of him, you know, and he goes from that to be a, now I'm going to sit my son down and tell him about the, it's like, I didn't even get it. All right. So anyways, this guy shines a light on this bullshit that's going on over there. And all of a sudden everybody's in an uproar. All of a sudden everybody gives a fuck about Uganda and these boy soldiers, you know? And all of a sudden, the United States government is going, dude, we're fighting two wars. We can't even afford to fight one. Now this guy's bringing this shit up. Gee, wouldn't it be nice if something fucking happened that would discredit him? Next thing you know, a couple days later, hey, this guy connected with the film from that Coney 2012 gets caught jerking off in public. Was I the only guy who found that unbelievably fucking convenient? I didn't buy it for a second. In fact, I tweeted, you know, back in the day, they used to assassinate you. Now they just do this. You know what I mean? If they can make it look like we landed on the moon in 1969, you don't think that they can make you, anybody they want, make it look like you're rubbing one out in the fucking parking lot? I don't buy it. What that fucking douchebag was doing, not douchebag, that fucking self-serving cunt. There we go. That's what I was trying to say. What he was doing with that film was he was putting pressure on the United States to go over there and fucking somehow insert themselves into that situation, which would have cost a ton of fucking money. You know? But there's no way to be like, hey, fuck those boy soldiers. You know? Because of the way, because of what it says in our pamphlet. You know, give us your weak, give us your poor, and we'll exploit the shit out of them and let them die of tuberculosis in a damp apartment. And then years later, whoever made the most amount of money gets a statue made out of them. That's all in our thing. So we can't look the other way with these fucking boy soldiers. So what's the easiest thing to do? Just make that guy look like a freak show. First of all, who hasn't jerked off in a parking lot, honestly? You know, who hasn't done that? You know, your fucking girl goes in to exchange something. You're sitting there. You're bored. You can't get any radio reception because, you know, it's back in the day. You just say,
I'm bored, right? You got a girl in your life, so you know there's going to be some sort of napkins in the car. What are you going to do, right? You got the captain's chairs. No one can see you. Oh, this is taking forever. Hey, what if I rub one out, right? But now everybody's got a fucking camera. You know what's amazing is that everybody hasn't got caught jerking off in public at this point. Everybody's got a camera in their cell phone. What I'm trying to say, people, is I don't buy it. And it doesn't matter. I don't give a fuck whether the guy from Coney was jerking off in a parking lot or not. That doesn't change whether or not there's boy soldiers in Uganda. But what's great is then the conversation switches from what's going on over there to, oh, what's this guy doing? Is he rubbing his dick like we all do? And then everybody would be like, yeah, but we don't do it in public. Oh, so what? That makes you better? Doesn't make you better. It just makes you more considerate. Doesn't it? I mean, if you had two people and they were both shooting heroin and one person had the decency to do it in their house and the other person does it out in public, at the end of the day, you're both drug addicts. So if you're really going to sit there and shit on this guy for jerking off, then you would have to basically be not jerking off at all. Right? Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I'm asking you to look into your hearts. If you have not rubbed one out, let he who has not rubbed one out in some sort of pub. No, you never jerked off at work. God, I'm fucking bored. Excuse me, let me go to the bathroom. Maybe they think I'm taking a shit standing up. Right? Come on. If you're a guy and your arms are long enough, at some point you've jerked off in some place where you shouldn't have. You jerked off to somebody you shouldn't have. You've done it. We've all been there. Who gives a fuck? There's still boys fighting in wars over there. So, you know, if you want to help out, help out. If you don't, don't. But don't let some guy rubbing one out in a parking lot change your mind either way. You know what they're doing right now? They're doing what women do when they argue, when they start to lose, is they bring up other shit and they spin it into a different room. And next thing you know, you're arguing a whole different argument, an argument that they wanted you to fucking argue so they knew that they could win, rather than keeping the argument on fucking track of saying, listen, sweetheart, I don't like the way you've fucking been dressing lately, okay? I got in this relationship to treat you like a piece of fucking meat, all right? And lately, you've been slacking off. People are still boy soldiers in Uganda. Whether or not that guy's rubbing one out or opening his ass for the world to see. Don't ever forget that. Don't lose sight of what the real story is, okay? That is all. Good night, and God bless the United States of America. Chick advice. Hey, Bill, I'm 25 and I've been listening to your podcast for a year now and I really enjoy it. I want to get your advice on my current situation. I could have assumed all of that because I'm arrogant. And why else would you write in? Okay, after a lot of failed relationships, I wanted to try a new approach of meeting women. I met a 21-year-old girl through my sister-in-law and figured she was interesting and pretty enough to consider for a serious girlfriend. We started hanging out as friends so I could be sure that I was, in fact, able to be friends with her before I made a move to something more serious. Things have been going well for the last 2 months, and we get together a couple times a week to hang out and do stuff. Well, last week, I finally decided that I wanted to make my move on her. I was saying goodbye to her after hanging out, and I finally moved in for a kiss, and she backed away. It got really awkward after that. And she kind of said, oh, I have to go. About 10 minutes later, I got a text from her saying, sorry for backing away, but I don't want to ruin our friendship. Oh, dude, you fucking waited too long. I would go watch that Chris Rock special where he does the friend zone. Anyways, he says, what the hell do I do now? She has always been very flirty with me the entire time we've been hanging out. Oh, wait, she's been flirty with you? Oh, fuck her. She works at an all-girls camp during the summer, and she always hangs out with me on her days off, so I know there isn't anyone else she is seeing. All right, first of all, scratch that. All right, you have no idea. How does that expression go? You know, only the devil knows the secrets in a woman's heart. Isn't that how it goes? Something like that. Don't ever fucking... You have no... I don't give a fuck. Okay, you could have a woman in a goddamn cell. You still have no idea what the fuck they're doing. They're sorcerers. Anyways, am I to believe she is so naive to think that we were just hanging out as total platonic friends? The only reason I could think why she would do that is because I am agnostic and she is a semi-religious girl. What do you think I should do? You know what you should do? Fucking walk. Robert De Niro in Heat. Just walk away. All right? Just walk away. This is what you do. All right? This girl's being all flirty with you and all that type of shit. She gets your dick hard. You're trying to be a gentleman. You don't try to fucking finger blast her on the first date because you think she's special. All right? So 3 days after flying kites and going on picnics, you go in for a kiss. She pulls up. I didn't want to ruin the friendship. Give me a fucking break. She knows what the fuck she's doing. All right? She's toying with you. So this is what you do. This is the best thing that you can do when a woman does something like that that makes you want to go out and eat fucking sheet metal is you don't give them the emotion that they want, which is they want you to be upset. And I don't know why. I don't know fucking why, but she wants you to be upset. So this is what you do. Okay? You just say, oh, yeah, hey, I didn't know what I was doing. That's cool. Whatever. All right? And then she'll be like, I still want to be friends. And be like, yeah, absolutely. We can totally be friends. All right? So don't try to fucking bang her anymore. Don't blow her off so she has no idea what you're doing. Just keep hanging out with her, whatever, doing this and that. And then what you do, just start fucking working out. You get jacked. Right? And then on the side, you start talking to other broads. And then one day you show up with a fucking goddamn hickey on the side of your neck. You know? And then you fucking just don't even address it. What's that? I was hanging out with some girl last night. So what are you doing today? And you mind fuck her right back. You fight fire with fire. That's what you do. Get on with your life, sir. Fuck her. That's it. All right? That's it. That's what I feel. My solution is always the same, okay, is whenever a girl does some shit like that, all right, or if a girl breaks up with you or anything like that, and if a girl still wants to be friends with you after she broke up with you, don't, all right? You get the fuck away from her. Hurt locker, okay? Put on your bomb suit and fucking walk away. Don't be the hero. You fucking walk away. Because they just want to keep you in their life as they slowly get over you and just constantly be taking a steak knife and shoving it into your heart. Fuck that. All right? You get away from them. There's no point being around this girl. So right now, this girl just tried to mind fuck you. So if you do automatically just cut off being around her, she's going to win on some level. And she'll actually get some sort of level of satisfaction that you reacted that way. Because even though you think you're saying fuck you, what you're really saying is I actually cared about you. And that's going to feed her goddamn ego. So don't do that. So just be like, yeah, I don't know what I was thinking, you know? You can't blame a guy for trying. That'll annoy her. Like she's just some piece of meat you took a swing at. This is such terrible fucking advice. But you know what? I believe in it. This is how I've lived my life. If you want to end up like me, 43, not married, no kids, that's how you do it. I don't know. Yeah, just whatever. She wants to hang out. Yeah, hey, let's hang out. And don't be weird around her. Don't be weird. Hey, sorry about that. I don't know. I was an idiot or whatever. That's what you do. All right? And then what you do
is start talking about some other girl. Wait a couple of weeks and just say, hey, you know, I kind of met this girl. I kind of like her and blah, 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 blah. You know, this is the old hook and lateral play. I don't know if this will work. This is definitely a Hail Mary. But maybe if you fucking start saying, hey, you know, I met this girl. I, you know, I kind of fucking like her. You show up with the hickey on your neck. I don't know what happens. The muscles around their spinal cord get fucking, they get weak. You know, and all of a sudden they just fall face first into your lap. Sometimes that happens, you know, but you're not going to know unless you try it. All right. Don't be Chris Webber and be looking to pass the fucking ball here. You want to take the shot. You understand me? So that's what you do. Sometimes I say this shit and I step outside of myself and I just realize what a fucking moron I sound like. But I don't know. For some reason, you guys listen to this shit. So whatever. Good luck to you. I just tapped. What is it?
Hungry minds
do stare
you in the eye. Spread it thick and lay the biggest lies. Don't say what you're feeling. Must play hard to get. All those time bombs sticking in your head. So much pressure to keep holding on. Back my clothes up, baby, I'll be gone. I got to stir it up. Got to break it up now. And I think about tomorrow.
We're going to do something a little different this week. Rather than me just sitting here in my pajamas.
Ranting
and raving. I decided that I would get clothed this week and have a friend of mine come by. The one and only Dom Irrera, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Do you mind if I get undressed?
Huh? No.
I would feel more comfortable doing this show. I like in the nude.
In the nude.
In the nude. Not
in
just
nude
naked.
Podcast.
In the nude. Well, I realize now, you know, like, look how much weight I've gained, right? Now, you know, I've gained, since I've known you, 30 pounds, right? And I know that.
I can't tell.
Well, you don't really look, you don't really
well,
check
you,
me
well,
out.
You know what it is. Oh, Doc.
Look at my head. My head is bigger.
Well, you're wearing that slimming black t-shirt.
I've got a Barry Bonds head. But it's interesting because now, and I don't even know if this is a bit yet, Bill, but I think there's something in it. I have to look, I don't like women my own age.
Right.
You know what I mean? I can't fake that I get aroused by them.
I always wondered that.
No.
I always wondered, like,
I mean, I wish I had that kind of love or something, but I need, like, a hot young chick. But the only hot young chick I'm going to get has to be flawed.
Right.
You know, she's got to be, has daddy issues.
Inside
or something.
Or outside, yeah.
Yeah, she's got to be messed up in some way, but that's what I'm looking for.
How many strippers have you dated?
Dated? Only a couple. I was in love with one.
How old were you when you made that move?
2 years ago.
You fell in love with a stripper.
I fell in love with
her.
Yeah, which, first of all,
is this a country song?
She was. Really, I fell in love. With, she was not stripping at the time. She was bartending and just giving an occasional lap dance.
Okay. You know,
and really beautiful girl.
I think I've been to that bar.
And fun, but I tell you, Oxycontin and alcohol really mess you up.
Yeah.
I don't know if you knew that. But,
yeah, I got some.
But I still love the girl. But she's. I don't think we're getting back together because
that Oxy.
Her
is,
husband and her two kids keep blocking us.
Oh Jesus, Dom! You're making me feel good. You're making me feel good. Some of the choices I made back in the day, dude. Oxy is
It's heroin, right?
Yeah, that's one of those things. Like even when you get off it, you're. I don't know that you're ever. Depending on how long you do it, the same. I lost a buddy of mine to that.
Oh
shit,
really?
And I got another one. He's not doing so well.
Did you grow up in a neighborhood that was a lot of drugs?
Not like that. Not like that. It was, I grew up, you know, it was cul-de-sac bullshit. It was weed. There was the weed guy. There was the bookie. And then there was, you know, booze, obviously. But, you know, and some coke when you got older. But, like, nobody was doing, like, heroin. And crack was, like, you're out of your fucking mind. Because everybody thought if you smoke crack, that was it. You were done.
Well, yeah, they say you get addicted the first time. Now,
that's what they said, but I got friends of mine who did, and they're like, yeah, you know, okay, it was all right.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, maybe they're addicted to other things. They didn't have time to be addicted.
Maybe they're
to
just better people than
maybe
us,
they're
dog.
Better, stronger. You have good friends. Let me ask you this. If you had one drug that you think you would like, what would it be? I know what mine is.
If I could do a drug that I've never tried,
you've
that
never
I would
tried,
like,
and you think that and like it's not going to have any repercussions, you just want the feeling. What feeling would it be?
I have a tie.
What
is? I want to know what it feels like that train spotting where you sink into the rug. the first time you do heroin.
That's exactly what I want.
That, but I got to admit the hallucinating thing, tripping.
Yeah.
Somebody told me, like, he said, like, when you're tripping, it's not like you don't know that you're tripping. You see the door fucking melting. You're like, oh, it's because I'm on acid. It's not like those high school films where you'd be like, you thought you could fly and dumb shit like that.
Jump out the window. No, that would scare the shit out of me.
What was that movie where that old guy? Was it something?
Timothy Leary?
Alan Arkin did a part where he played an old guy and he fucking, he got addicted to heroin in like his 70s. And he's just like, what the fuck? I'm 70.
That's actually a good idea.
Just to try it at 70?
I mean, I'd rather go out shooting drugs than go out taking, you know...
Dick in the ass?
Dick in the ass, yeah. That must hurt, man. That's the thing. You ever think about that seriously, Bill?
Accepting one, I think.
Taking one for the team.
Yeah, taking one for the team. All right, Dom, your number came up. Sorry. You're not going to like this. You're not going to like this job.
I don't think so. Could we work this out?
No, I've actually thought
about...
Are
you really a priest?
How I want to go out.
Yeah. Eaten by wolves. Shredded by animals.
Yeah, I either want to live to be like 105, like you live so long that there's like nobody at your funeral because you outlived everyone.
Yeah.
Who gives a shit? Or, no. You know, because that is
a funny image.
Because that's one of the things. If you live long enough, there's
everyone. I'm sure he had people that cared about.
Oh yeah, like people doing the eulogy. Like, I mean, you know, I met him when he was 87, and you know, he was old. He liked playing cards. He always wore those slippers. But if you die, like, you know, like all my friends, you know, who have died tragically fucking young, it seems. I mean, you pack the house and everybody's up there crying.
Yeah. You get a good...
That's the only good thing about dying young is everybody gives a fuck. There's articles written about you. There's nothing worse than dying young. But dying old also is, you know, you're sitting there and you got that fucking old terrified picture.
My Uncle Tony, when he died, he really was very prejudiced and very angry. But he also loved his children. He loved God. He loved mountains. And then when he died, it was so funny.
Does that make up for the racist side?
Yeah. But I'm saying he was that balance.
He burned crosses on people. But in the nature. Love birds.
But it's true, though. He was really like all that. Yeah. And we're standing around a coffin.
You see that mountain? It's for us. That's for us, not these other people.
This is God's country. But when we're around the coffin, we're standing. You know, people lie about people after they die. And this guy, Lee Fidelli, who was the first Italian character I ever did, like I got down a little, he said, we're standing there, me, a friend of mine is a priest, and like a couple of my cousins, and we're standing there over the body, and he goes, he never had a bad word to say about anybody. And we went from crying to fucking laughing. And I'm thinking, I said, all he did was have bad words to say about everybody. And then he goes, listen to this, this is a really old reference. He goes, he never hated anybody except Larry Boa. Right? Larry Boa, the old for the Phillies.
Yeah, second.
And he looks up, he goes, he hated that motherfucker with a vengeance, huh?
Was he a gambler?
No, he didn't gamble. He just hated him. He hated Larry Boa because he hit 175, but he was a great fielder. But I mean, what an obscure reference to make at a funeral.
So in general, back in the day, he probably just didn't like second baseman. Right. Straight across the board.
Yeah.
But I love that everybody laughed. I've had a couple of those at like funerals.
We went from crying to crying laughing.
I did that one time. A buddy of mine, his dad died, and it was just one of those fucking, you know, tragic, you know, we were young and he died out of nowhere and the kid had already lost his mom. It was fucking horrible. And so it was pouring raining to make it even worse. Fucking, like, remember the movie Seven? It was raining like that. Okay.
Yeah.
So we, you know, go through the service and now they're going to, you know, put the guy in the ground. And the guy was so popular. I mean, there was just a zillion people there. So they had like one of these, you know, one of those pop tents with no sides to it.
Mm-hmm.
So there's so many fucking people. Everybody's jamming in there. Me and my buddy can't get in. You know, we're on the outer ring. We're just getting rained on and shit. And my other asshole friend is just inside the tent and he's sitting there. We're all crying and stuff and they're bringing the body down. And all of a sudden, just from the weight of the rain, like this little like canal started pouring down and just missing my friend. And my buddy, in the middle of crying, was standing right, just reached up and adjusted it so it went all over his coat. But he had like this wool kind of coat on so he couldn't feel it at first. Right. And dude, I'm talking crying laughing.
Yeah.
Just crying because it was so sad. And that's the thing, too, that I never thought people ever understand about comics when they have a distasteful joke. Like if a boat sinks, there's a plane crash, and you have a joke. Yeah. They always think it's because you're insensitive, and they sometimes don't understand that it's a defense mechanism. Where it's
twisting
like,
the pain.
Yeah, I'm feeling something bad. I don't want to feel it. And then you make a fucking joke. Yeah. And then you're laughing because you don't want to feel that. So you're actually doing it because you can. It's kind of a form of a dysfunction. It's kind of a form of dysfunction.
Well, like the pedophile jokes. We all know how terrible that is. And
yet, well, you know, I think there's instances.
But you could twist it around. I usually bring it back on myself, you know. Mm-hmm. Like one joke that says, you know, what about me, father? I wasn't hot enough for you. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like that kind of thing. To make it me, I wouldn't want to hurt a kid. But there's a good example of something that's caused so many people so much pain. And I'm not just talking about the physical pain.
Yeah.
But, you know, we do.
Oh, no, you end somebody's life. That's why that Sandusky guy, yeah, you know, like they shouldn't put those. They should automatically get the death penalty just immediately.
Yeah.
It's all. They take them out. Dude, if you got a rabid dog in your neighborhood, you fucking put it down. Those sex offender guys, that's it. Because all those people that dude fucked with,
yeah,
it's like that's going to now affect – you want to talk about dating strippers, like how that's going to affect who they pick, you know, who they pick as a wife, how they treat their kids. They might think they there's a chance that they could – you know, sometimes – I don't know if it happens. I'm going to go beyond – my intelligence on this shit, which isn't too hard to do, but all I know is that that's generations of therapy.
Yeah, because of the abuse of the
they
repeat the whoever.
Yeah, and those guys,
they don't get therapy.
Yeah, and you can't put that guy in jail. And like, I mean, how long? Like, you're attracted to what you're attracted to, and no amount in a cell.
Well, especially
like
that.
Dom, if they stuck you in a cell, how long before you wouldn't like big titted strippers? You'd come out 80 years later, I'm Dom. Bring me to some big-titted stripper. Those guys like 8-year-olds. You stick them in a cell and you talk to them. You try to undo it and show them an adult. They're wired that way. That's it.
How just fucking sick is
just
that?
Put him down. It's horrific. It's why I don't believe in a higher power that gives a fuck.
Well, that's a whole different subject, but I understand that. But do you hear that pedophile joke about – you might have to tell a joke?
No, not at all.
It's two guys sitting on a bench. I see an 11-year-old boy walk by. One guy, pedophile, he says to the other one, he goes, boy, he must have been hot back in the day. He must have been something back in the day.
Oh, that's fucking twisted.
Yeah.